Hello everyone, it's me Tiger. Welcome back to my channel. Today we are here again on Sedona Island with another episode of my Let's Play series. In this episode, we will be doing a fun neighborhood speed build. I'm really excited for y'all to see this one. I think it turned out really cute. Also, thank you to Surfshark for sponsoring today's video. Now, let's get started with the build. You guys may recognize this area that is on the far left of my island in front of my museum. I have a lot of scattered villager homes here, and this part of my island has just been a mess, honestly, since I started. Today we are finally going to clean up this area and turn it into an aesthetic small town neighborhood with 4 villager homes. I of course had to start out by moving all of the houses that were already over here so that they would be out of the way and I could fix up the road and figure out exactly the layout that I wanted for the neighborhood. I wasn't going to make this video a speed build at first, but once I started moving all of these houses, I realized it was going to take a very long time to finish this build completely, so I have sped up the footage for us today. Also, apologies if my voice sounds really nasally. I am having some allergies because, you know, it's cedar season here in Texas. There's a lot of pollen and cedar, and yeah. Anyways, we're listening to some great music by Demon Gummies today, so be sure to check out their socials in the description if you like it and would like to hear more. Once the road was renovated and all houses were out of the way, it was time to start moving them back to their permanent, more organized spots. We do have 4 villagers living here, including Fauna, Marshall, Poncho, and Sylvia. I decided to give each of them 4 squares of space between their houses so I could fit and decorate front yards for each villager. It ended up working perfectly with the space that I had. If you're making a neighborhood like this on your island, I highly recommend counting how many squares of space you have and planning out the layout beforehand, because it made it a lot easier for me and I was able to give them like the same amount of space between each house, and yeah, you get the point. I started out with decorating the house closest to the museum. This is Fauna's home, my favorite villager ever. I wanted her to be right by the museum because I could just envision her working there, taking care of the plants and maybe the bugs. I used the light dirt pathing to lay out an area for her front porch, and then I went back over that later with a light wooden plank path design. I thought that this would give the illusion of a deck or a front porch, and by the way, all design codes I use on this island are listed in the description below if you're looking to download any. I use the metal and wood table and chairs, which look like they belong in a garden, and also they match her house perfectly. I don't know if I'll go back later and renovate any of these house exteriors once I get that option from Happy Home Paradise, but for now I think they look pretty okay as is. I made sure to include lots of plant items and decor around Fauna's house. I even added some behind it as well. Since the areas in front of the house are pretty small, there wasn't a lot of room for any like detailed builds or like, you know, a big extravagant yard, so I just tried to give each villager some simple seating and a few personalized decor items that would kind of showcase their personality. Now we were ready to start working on Marshall's home, who lives right in front of Fauna. I think he autofilled a plot a while back, so if you guys don't remember Marshall moving onto my island, that's why. I could picture Marshall as an author who chose a spot near the museum so he could use their Wi-Fi, since the rest of the island plots are in more remote areas, like in the woods. With that in mind, I decorated his area with a lot more modern vibe. I used simple fencing and, again, the light wooden plank to create a front deck area. To finish off Marshall's area, I gave him a nice laptop so that he could use the museum's free Wi-Fi. And if you use free Wi-Fi often, like Marshall, you should probably get protected with a VPN like Surfshark. Thank you so much to Surfshark VPN for sponsoring today's video. Surfshark keeps your online identity safe by encrypting all of the information sent between your device and the internet. It also swaps your real location with a new one, aka changing your IP address, so that you can virtually travel to any country around the globe. So next time you're using free public Wi-Fi at McDonald's like Marshall, you can secure your personal information meaning hackers and attackers can only see your VPN IP, keeping your true IP safe and hidden. Changing your IP location also means access to content libraries and streaming services from other countries. This is my favorite part about using a VPN like Surfshark. I like to use it to access Japan Netflix so I can watch anime shows I would otherwise not be able to watch in the US. And trust me, they have way better options. You can get Surfshark VPN using my link down below. Enter promo code TIGER in all caps for 83% off and 3 extra months for free. Using a VPN like Surfshark will ensure privacy and protection across all devices while browsing the internet. Thank you again to Surfshark VPN for sponsoring today's video. Let's get back to building our neighborhood. I finished up Marshall's area by making his porch a little bit bigger, and I also gave him a cute lawnmower. And then I started working on some of the surrounding neighborhood areas, like near the sidewalk and whatnot. I did time travel a few days to get some trees grown, and this is what the neighborhood is looking like so far. It's looking adorable. It's definitely giving small town vibes. I think the coconut trees on the beach also added a really nice touch to this area. Altogether, I'm pretty happy with how this is turning out. Poncho's house was next up for renovation, and his area is a bit larger than everyone else's. He gets the peninsula area all to himself. He is one lucky dude, and I wanted to make the peninsula a fishing slash hangout area with a nice walkway to his front yard. So I opened up the Island Designer app and started making a stone pathway leading from his house to the peninsula so we could connect all of it together. To use the party lights arch for this spot because it looks so cute, and in my opinion it creates a very warm community feel, and I could also just imagine Poncho having his neighbors or friends or family over here to hang out and fish and whatnot. I also added some other items to go along with this idea, like a picnic basket, fishing rods, and also some more seating. Part of the pathway looked really flat and uninteresting, so I wanted to use a larger item here to take up space and add more height and detail. I also covered the ground in custom codes as well to give more detail and make the space look more crowded. I thought the pergola item would fit perfectly here, and I'm not gonna lie, I was right. It looks so good in this spot. I love how you can walk through it too, so it doesn't block the walkway from Poncho's yard to the peninsula area. After that, I worked on his yard some more, just adding some seating and other items that I thought would fit into the area and also fit his personality. I'm not sure if Poncho will be a permanent resident of Sedona. He was one of my starter villagers, but I will admit that he's grown on me, and I'm kind of happy to decorate such a cool space for him. Thank you. was working on the beach areas that are directly to the left of the neighborhood, I decided to give each villager their own beach area connected to their yards. This was a great way to fill up these beaches, which if you watch my channel often, you know how much I dislike decorating beaches. It is so hard. It's always nice when your inland builds sort of spill over into the beach. It makes it easier than having to come up with a whole new build idea for the beach. So yeah, this part was kind of scattered. There's not much commentary I could do. I wasn't really decorating them like one at a time. I was just throwing stuff all over the beach and it was very scattered, but yeah. Now it's time to work on the last home, Sylvia's house. Sylvia is definitely not staying on my island forever, so I decided to keep this area pretty neutral. I might adjust it later depending on who moves into this plot and what their personality is like. I did use brick this time instead of wood for the porch so that there would be some variety in the neighborhood. Since Sylvia's house was at the end of the neighborhood, sort of at the entrance, I tried to focus more on landscaping the area around her house with flowers and bushes as well as fencing to make it look as pretty as possible, you know, because it's the first house you see when you walk into the neighborhood, so I wanted it to look very cute and clean. I also decorated the beach area in front of her house off camera, which you will see in a few minutes or moments, I don't know yet, but you'll see it soon when we do the final walkthrough. Alright y'all, get ready for the final walkthrough. The neighborhood is finished. Here is what it looks like when you walk in. We have Sylvia's lovely yard right away, looking very cute. I don't know if I like this table in front of her house, I might change that. But yeah, here's the beach right next to her house. So she has her own chairs, a little book, a yacht item, and it's kind of connected to Poncho's little peninsula area going on over here, which is honestly my favorite part of the build. It looks so cute. And then we have Poncho's yard. We got some cute decor here as well, some nice brick for his front porch, and yeah, I really like his house as well. And then we can keep going. Here's Marshall's house, so cute. He's got his Wi-Fi hooked up to the museum, you know, he's doing his own thing. I did remove that fence real quick so he could actually access his little private beach area, which again, just some chairs, some shoes, books, and whatnot, just to make it look like they have a private beach. You know, it looks good. Then we have this area. I really like this area. I used the steel fence item to make a barrier between that pond and the neighborhood, and I really liked it. And then this is Fauna's house with all of her little plant items, her little table and chairs, and that, my friends, is pretty much the entire neighborhood. We do have to go back here to access Fauna's beach area, so yeah, it's nothing special. Again, we got the chairs, we got a little snack for her, and then I also put a volleyball net up, so I guess that's different. And yeah, here's me getting stuck behind all of the trees, not knowing what I'm doing. Oh yeah, I did decide to remove a chair from Fauna's table so that she could actually access her beach. So yeah, I did do that. Now there's only one chair. It looks a little bit lame, but it, you know, it works. She can access her beach area now. Anyways, now you can see how this area flows with the museum. It looks really nice back there. And don't worry, I didn't forget. I'm gonna show you guys the beach in front of Sylvia's house, which is right down this way. It's okay. It's a work in progress. I don't know. It's kind of scattered. I might change up this area later. If you guys have any ideas, let me know. I just put some chairs and a little boat item, a lifeguard chair. Yeah. So anyways, that is the entire neighborhood build. I really hope that you guys enjoyed watching. If you did, leave a like and also consider subscribing to support the channel. And don't forget to check out Surfshark VPN. All of that information is down below in the description. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you guys next time. Have a great day. Bye.